Good morning, everyone. I think we've let everyone into the room at one time, so we are ready to roll this morning. I am David Carmichael, the Director of the State Archives, and I want to welcome you to the 2020 Archives and Records Management Seminar. This is our first attempt to do this entirely online, but that seems to be the new normal. So as we try to do this, if we have technical difficulties, I know that you will bear with us. Just a couple of housekeeping items to start with. All of the attendees are muted at the moment. That is for your protection and ours. But the chat box will be available to you to type your questions and comments during the presentations. You will find the chat box or the chat symbol down toward the bottom of your screen. Click on that, you will be able to see the chat if you can't see it at the moment. So please feel free to type your questions in. The archive staff will be monitoring the chat all through the presentations, and then we're going to save the questions to the end of each group of presentations. So at that point, they will read your questions and the presenters will answer them. I want to thank you, my slide wasn't there. I want to thank these organizations you see on your screen for supporting this seminar. The funding comes from NHPRC, the National Historical Publications and Records Commission. And of course, the Pennsylvania State Historical Records Advisory Board is a supporter of these seminars every year. And I want to thank the Pennsylvania Historical and Museum Commission, which is our parent organization here at State Archives. I want to remind you also that these sessions are being recorded, and the recording will be posted to the PHMC YouTube page soon after the seminar ends. And last reminder is the second session will start at 1:30 today. This same Zoom link that you received for this session will be used for that session. So feel free to come back at 1:30 after these sessions are over. All right, so we've had a little technical difficulty here. Our screen disappeared for a moment, but I think we're back, Cindy. We're not on the correct slide. So our first session today is Pants Optional. I didn't choose that title, I'll tell you that. But this is about archival projects that you can successfully implement from home, projects that have been successfully implemented from home. And you can see the speakers now on your screen. You could for a moment see the speakers on your screen. I'm going to tell you who they are anyway, and we will get our technical issues taken care of pretty quickly. The pandemic has affected all of us, which is why we're doing this online, as you can see. But many of us wondered when we closed our doors, are we going to be able to continue to serve our patrons? Will the staff continue to do their work? And so our speakers are going to talk about how they have managed the work from home for this extended period of time. Our first speaker will be Adam Bentz, who is the Assistant Director of Library and Archives at the York County Historical Center. Dr. Bentz earned his MA and PhD in history at Lehigh University and a BA in historical communications at Lebanon Valley College. He has served the cause of Pennsylvania history in many, many capacities, including as a professor, a member of the editorial board of the Pennsylvania History Journal, and a member of the State Historical Records Advisory Board, for which we thank him for his service. Heather Heckman is the head of collections management here at the Pennsylvania State Archives, and she is responsible for arranging and describing the archives records, as well as overseeing our digitization projects and putting all of our records online. All the records that we are putting online, she is responsible for doing. I can personally attest that she has kept her staff very productive and very engaged since we began working from home last March. And so Heather will have much to tell us. And then finally, Matt Strauss will be speaking. He is the director of the Library and Archives at the Senator John Heinz History Center, where he manages the acquisition, description, digitization, and preservation of the organization's library and archival collection. So we're going to kick off with Adam. There will be a little downtime between the speakers as we bring up the slides for the next speaker, but again, you will understand that from having done a lot of Zoom meetings probably. So I'm very happy you're here, and I'm happy to introduce this topic and have Adam Bentz take over from here. Thank you, Adam.
Thank you. All right. We'll see if this works out. If anyone can give me a thumbs up that you can see it, awesome. Wonderful. Okay. Thank you, David, for your introduction, and I really appreciate the opportunity to speak today from the State Archives inviting me to participate, and York County History Center is very happy to have this opportunity to share what we've been working on for the last few months. Obviously, this has been quite an event, to say the least, and when everything shut down for us, which was the week of St. Patrick's Day, I went home on Saturday and never went back until June. So it was really quite a rapid, well, everybody knows that, right? Everybody knows this is a rapid process. But what we did, I would say, within the first few weeks is try to figure out how to pivot from being a very much in-person-based organization to putting out as much online content as we could to maintain a presence in the community, to demonstrate our relevance, and so forth. Fortunately, as many organizations are aware, there have been funds available from the federal and state levels to maintain historical organizations, and with a specific focus of providing online content. So, my director, Nicole Smith, asked me to share this first slide here, which basically is something we worked on in the early summer and presented this, and we were able to secure some funding from the NEH based on our prioritizing digital content and public programs that could be made available through webinars and other things. So you can see quite a few things. We have... I wouldn't say we are a large organization, but we do have several departments that have different specialties. And we were all able to come together to pivot, I think, fairly successfully and to provide content that we had been doing in person and to be able to do it online. I will be talking about a number of things, especially the things you can see in objective number 3, and giving examples of those as I move forward. One of the things we did from the very beginning was to offer some free research, which is not usually in the best interest of historical organizations, because, of course, we depend on some of our operational budget on paid research requests. But what we wanted to do was to maintain, like I said, to maintain a presence in the community and to show that we were trying to help people out who weren't otherwise able to visit us during the shutdown. So we offered 1 free hour of research to people who submitted questions either by email or through our online submission page. And fortunately, because of about a quarter century worth of work that people have done through our Past Perfect catalog, we were able to do a lot of things for people without having access to the physical collections. The primary way that this helped us was in making photos available, not just to us for research purposes, but also to be able to process photo requests for people who were interested in different collections we had. And so this is one of the several ways we were able to help with research questions. People had questions about what buildings looked like at different times, or just very simply, do you have an image of this particular event or this particular person? Fortunately, we were able to help in a number of circumstances because of that and because of our all of the photos that have been scanned over the last few decades. Another thing that we've had access to, which is really not a surprise to anybody who's familiar with genealogy, is ancestry.com. And we were able to access this through our VPN working from home. And so for some pretty basic fundamental genealogy questions, I was able to do research using Ancestry to answer when was so-and-so born, or when does so-and-so appear in the census? Those very straightforward kinds of questions. But we also received a few business history questions. And fortunately, Ancestry has access to things such as the U.S. city directories. And quite a few city directories for the city of York, Pennsylvania, are available through Ancestry.com. Now, this would be a typical thing where people would send in an email or call us or come in to do research in person, and we just walk over to the bookshelf and pull down the city directory and answer the question. But how do you do that when you don't have access to the book? Well, again, this is why digitization is so wonderful, because we can employ the same basic research tools without having to be there in person. And very closely related to that, and I'll be talking about this a little bit more in a few minutes, is access to a website called newspapers.com, which again, I'm sure is familiar to many, many people. In the last 2 or 3 years, the York County History Center has worked in partnership with newspapers.com to make sure that the two main newspapers that cover York, City of York, and the county are fully digitized, that their microfilm is fully digitized and made searchable through newspapers.com. And of course, for those who know, newspapers.com is owned by Ancestry. It's very much part of the same company, and it is a for-profit service. However, we've been able to work out a pretty lucrative agreement with them to have this available for research purposes. Lucrative in terms of providing access to our patrons, not in terms of financial benefits. But that being said, having all of these things digitized made research possible off-site in a way that just simply would not have been possible 5 years ago, 10 years ago. You can't obviously use microfilm if you don't have it. You can't use microfilm if you have no access to a microfilm reader. But to have all of these things available, and not only that, to be word searchable was really phenomenal. And we were able to help out a lot of people over the months that we were closed down by using this service. So moving a bit beyond doing basic research requests for people, one of our other major focuses was providing online content. And we did this on our website, but we also made heavy use of our Facebook account. So during the summer, I developed a number of Facebook posts, and other people at the History Center did the same thing on various topics. A lot of them were intended to be anniversary kind of posts. And in this particular example that I have here, this was on the 48th anniversary of Hurricane or Tropical Storm Agnes, which devastated the Susquehanna Valley region all the way from the northeastern portion of Pennsylvania all the way down through York County. And it was destructive in York County as it was elsewhere. And in this particular circumstance, I found some photos related to Hurricane Agnes and the damage that it wreaked in our Past Perfect collection. So I was able to access these offsite, and then I found an article about this exact event when the roof of a covered bridge was actually lifted off of the frame of the building and put on top of a roadway. So I was able to put all of this into this Facebook post using, again, Past Perfect and using newspapers.com. And it was a pretty successful post. It was very interesting. Things related to natural disasters usually generate a lot of interest online. And this was just one example of posts that we had done to try to demonstrate that we were still trying to be engaged with the public, that we were still trying to provide knowledge about York County's past, even though we could not have people in person. Another thing we focused on, as many organizations did, was developing webinars. And I did not participate in this particular webinar, but my director, Nicole Smith, did. And she joined our director of collections, Rachel Warner, in what we call a second Saturday webinar. And they discussed primarily collections care, how to care for objects. And there was also some discussion of caring for documents and photographs. There were several people who wrote in asking questions about particular items they had at home. And so this is, again, a way of interacting with the public and providing content at the same time. So I said I would talk about newspapers.com in a little bit more detail. And I took a presentation I had done at a conference and turned it into a webinar, which we used in early May. And this webinar was essentially about what we had done with our partnership with newspapers.com, but also more generally, I talked about the benefits of having digital newspapers, and especially word searchable newspapers. This is a pretty successful webinar, and it's hard to believe for people that work in the history business, so to speak, that there are people out there who don't know the value of these kinds of things, but we were able to reach some people who were not familiar with what had been done recently and what a tremendous advantage digitized newspapers are. One of the other webinars that we did that went well and was, again, timely, as well as a way of creating partnerships that we had not really attempted before. I participated in a webinar that was organized by the York County Economic Alliance. And you can see the speakers. Dr. Scott Knowles from Drexel University had been having what he called COVID talks for several weeks before we participated in this event. And he had been talking to people from various localities across the state about the impact of the Spanish flu on Pennsylvania 102 years ago. And Dr. Silas Chamberlain of the YCEA participated, and we were also very fortunate to have Craig Walt from the York Bureau of Health. And so we were able to provide historical perspective on various pandemics in America's past, and specifically on the so-called Spanish influenza of 1918-1919. And then also to have a frank discussion about what COVID-19 was doing both statewide and locally in York. And Craig was very helpful in providing some real-time information about how it was affecting the population of the city of York. This was an interesting collaboration, and unfortunately we haven't been able to duplicate it more recently just because of the many other things the History Center and the Economic Alliance have been working on. But we are hoping to return to this sort of meeting of the minds, or at least conversations about the interactions between history and present day events. We're going to try to do that in the future. Another kind of online content that we were working on was developing story maps. And this is something that we've made available through a program called ArcGIS. And our library registrar, Brian Bailey, developed this, and this was received very, very graciously, a phenomenal reception. And it looks great and it tells a great story. We had received some photos in, I think, either last year or this year that were donated to the History Center collections. And they told the story of several local women who made a cross-country trip in the summer of 1938. And so what Brian was able to do with this story is to document each place they visited through photographs. So you can see that there were many different places in the country that they visited, and there's a little story, a little write-up about each of these places, and it features a photograph that the ladies actually took. This just turned out really well. Not only is it a local story about local people, they had several relatives in the area who could relate to this, but it connected to a more nationwide story of how people were able to explore the country after the automobile became more available and after they became more reliable, roads were more reliable. So it was a great way for us to tell a local story with national relevance, I guess you could say.
Hey Adam, it's Josh. I just wanted to give you the 2-minute warning.
Okay, very good. Well, I will just go through a few more of these things that we did with online content. We have what we call the History at Home page, which if you're interested in York County or just you're interested in what we set up, there's a whole lot of content we've made available on History at Home. Something I did in August was an interview related to military history. from our collections, and I interviewed one of our members about his research on that. That's on our History at Home page. Again, tied into the Spanish flu, this is not online content, but we did an article related to Spanish flu in York County and ran it in our most recent newsletter. I'm not going to jump on top of what Matt's going to be talking about, but unsurprisingly, we have a call for COVID-19 related stories and photographs, as many organizations have done. Okay, and getting to perhaps the less interesting portion here, we also took some time to catch up on projects that we had not had time for because obviously we are open to the public. I worked for several weeks on developing some finding aids, one of them related to the Civil War, where I took the information we had on Past Perfect and put it into a greatly expanded spreadsheet, which we hope to upload to the website. I similarly did the same thing on a collection related to World War II General Jacob Devers, who is a York native. And we have his papers and his extensive photograph collection. And I updated a spreadsheet based on the folders and the photos themselves and trying to categorize them to create a finding aid, of course. I also worked a little bit on trying to correct some gaps in our Past Perfect catalog based on original accession sheets. So not terribly exciting, but very important things that we were able to do from home when we weren't working on research and developing content. And then probably as many people have done this, I'll just conclude with this. I was able to catch up on a lot of secondary source reading related to York County topics, which has actually been quite helpful in developing content as well as answering a number of questions that have come in since the summer. And again, as many people have done, I participated in some refresher courses and other webinars from other organizations. So with that, I think I've kind of given you a picture of what we worked on. Again, I think our organization was pretty successful at pivoting, and we're happy with the results. So thank you very much for this opportunity. We'll stop my share.
Thank you, Adam, and we'll transition over to Heather Heckman.
Hello, everyone. Let me just move this little box out of my way here. So I'm going to talk a bit about our transition to teleworking at the Pennsylvania State Archives, focusing mostly on my own section, collections management. So just to give you an idea of who my section is, we have a group of about 8 people. Our primary responsibility is to process our incoming records and to work on processing our manuscript collections that are already in-house, most of them. We prepare conservation projects and work with outside vendors on those. At the beginning of March, we shipped out another group of motion picture films, and we've been working on digitizing a large collection of nitrate negatives that we have in our freezer. And we have been preparing for the last 3 or so years on moving out of the current State Archives building and into a new building that is being built right now. We update our finding aids and inventory systems, and we find them quite exciting. Our finding aid is a live web-based system, so anytime we make an update, it is available to the public. And we have been reformatting thousands and thousands of rolls of microfilm from our reference room and putting them into a publicly accessible system that's provided by our state library called Power Library. And in that is something called PA Photos and Docs, and we put a lot of information in that, including image collections. So really, our job is to make government and non-government records available to the public. We're the in-between step. So you all may remember a long time ago in March, I'm not sure what happened at your organization, but at ours, all of our upper level managers sort of disappeared into meetings. They were very hard to find. And they asked us to please think about ideas of projects for people that they could work on from home. And where I work, think usually means plan. So we started planning things. And our state archivist was really clear during a very early meeting that when we think about planning these projects, they should be meaningful and not busy work. And that has been a vital thing to keep people engaged during telework, that they're invested in their projects. At one point, right before we left, I asked my direct supervisor, hey, how long should these projects last? And he's like, well, maybe like a week, but longer, but we don't know. And there was a sense that, you know, we had never really teleworked before. So this was really a foreign concept for us. So we needed to prepare, but we didn't know how long we would be preparing for. During this time, we also were getting, you know, current contact information. Does everybody have internet access? Do you have Wi-Fi? Can you do this? Can you telework? And I wanted to share with you a couple of ways that I think at the State Archives we were lucky and we were sort of accidentally prepared. And that was because in the background, you know, as a state agency, another part of us, our IT department, was slowly dragging us forward, even if we didn't know that that was really happening. So we had Skype for Business installed when we got new phones. And I'll be honest, we did Skype for Business training, and we had no idea when or why we would use this because the Wi-Fi in our building didn't really work very well. So we weren't going to be taking our new laptops that we had recently gotten anywhere else because they weren't going to be connected to our web-based systems. Our finding aid is on the web. So if we don't have the web, we can't update it. So we were sort of locked into our desk areas for the most part. But we also were slated to get new computers during this time, and we had an option. And many of us chose to get laptops at that point with a docking situation and two screens, which many of us learned to love and embrace a lot. So I was very lucky because most of my staff had a laptop, which made it much easier to transition to telework. They had something to take home. We had also, again, our IT magically working ahead of us, not even knowing this was coming, had us, most of you have shared drives that you work on, and we did too, and we had a personal drive, and they had transitioned us to a cloud-based OneDrive system. We had timelines and schedules, and we had to get our things moved over to this. And again, none of us knew why we were doing this. We were just doing what we were supposed to do, marching along. And I would say that at the beginning of March, on March 13th, when we transitioned to telework after that day, some of us had VPN access so we could access our shared drives. But many of us did not get added to that capability until later this summer. So although nothing on this screen was something that we were in charge of, it helped all of us be able to function from home. So I will say that on March 13th, which is a Friday, I told my staff something that was really uncomfortable and weird. I told them to take their laptops home. I told some of them to take hard drives with actual work on at home. And this was really out of our norm. It is not something as state employees that we were comfortable with the idea of taking state property home. It felt uncomfortable. I had spent the first 2 weeks of March preparing an initial project, which was to take old finding aid listings and have 23 people of all different comfort levels take this data and put it into simple Excel spreadsheets. I created sample spreadsheets for two collections for each of the 23 people. I created instructions. It was overwhelming and it was a lot. And we were asking people who did not work in Excel, had perhaps never opened Excel, to begin helping us with sort of a dream project. We were going to be changing our finding aid system from something called Archon into Eloquent during these summer months and this fall. And I didn't ever believe that I would have the opportunity to have 23 people spend 5 days a week transitioning this information into uploadable spreadsheets. But this was a really great opportunity for us, and we took it. And for any staff person that could work on their regular work, they continue to do so. So I had staff that were uploading microfilm and uploading postcards and making those available. We continued with some research projects. And so all of those things moved along. And for all those people that were creating those initial spreadsheets, we were able to actually upload many of them before our old finding aid was shut down. So it was amazing to get all of that moved forward. For us, one of the really nice things was that on the Wednesday of our first week telecommuting, we had a supervisor meeting, and very quickly we said, we need to document what we're doing each day. We need to be able to show what we're doing and that everyone is engaged in their projects. And I will say that for me, I asked my staff to email me at the end of each day with their progress. It meant that I had contact with everybody each day. It's October. We are still mostly telecommuting. So it gives us a way of staying in contact every day. It may be quick or it may be longer. We have learned to use our cell phones, our home lines, our Skype for Business telephone feature, which I'm going to tell you, it took us a little while to even figure out that that was a thing. And we have continued to buddy people up on projects through this process to keep people engaged with each other. This summer, we got cameras for our laptops, which was quite exciting, so that when you're having big meetings and conversations, you can see who's coming in and out. And I would say that by documenting our daily work, it's been important for us because it actually shows what we've accomplished. Because we've been doing this for over 6 months now. And time moves very strangely in this environment. I'm just going to share some what I call new truths. Like, working at home is very different than working in the office. If something goes wrong in the office, it's the office's situation to deal with. If the power goes out, if the Wi-Fi gets broken, it's not your responsibility. So I'll say that for working from home, I've learned that my office chair is better than I ever thought it was. And I mean, it has a rip on the back. It's not fancy. I really miss my two screens from work. Nobody in my home has any clue what I do, so they don't relate to me in that way. And that is a sad thing that I miss. There aren't any candy jars here or chocolate tins. We have a puzzle table where we work, where people just gather during breaks and chat. And it's not about work. It is just getting to know each other and talking about the weekend, future plans, and those connections. I think we really are all missing those. I spoke to one colleague the other week about, you know, missing all of the accidental exercise that we get because our building is kind of large. And, you know, you can log in over 10,000 steps a day just doing your work. And I really miss, I think for our section, we really miss touching our records and sharing whatever strange discovery we have found. We really enjoy that. And it is something that we are missing. Another really nice thing for us is that we were given permission to have people change lanes. So they're able to work on projects that perhaps aren't managed by their supervisor. I had 23 people working on that initial project, but during that time, which I'm going to be honest, was stressful, it gave another team a chance to organize and prepare an oral history transcription project, which is amazing. And another supervisor, you know, threw out this idea like, hey, we have 300 volumes of copied land survey books and we don't have any way to really index or access them. So if we could get people working on this, this is a huge, crazy project that we would never be able to do on site, but we have people working on this, most of them clerks, and it's going to provide an amazing resource at the end for people to really access those records easily. So by not limiting ourselves, we've been able to ensure that everyone has meaningful work, and it is often not the work they would do if they were in the office. I would say for us that this telework time, I've kind of looked at it as a gift in some ways. Most of us have things that are digitized, but we all know that really digitizing it is sometimes the easiest part. The part that takes the most amount of time is adding all of that metadata and then getting it publicly available and uploaded into some kind of system. And so we've been able to do a lot while we've been home. I've had one staff person who might have spent half of their time uploading postcards, and even several months ago, we had more than doubled the number of postcards we had available. We have a collection of over 30,000 postcards that represents all 67 counties in Pennsylvania. And it's an exciting project that has been moving slowly but forward. But nothing like this. It's only through telework that we can do this amount of uploading. Oral history transcription, again, important. Did we have time to do it while we were on site? No. And I would say that for me, because my section does work on conservation, that those, I always have dreams that when our conservation projects come back that we can upload them. And I want to do it right away. And I know that the metadata is going to take forever. And I know it's all work and it gets squeezed out often. But I do know that my little dream of uploading our Aero service images that we received back last year is something that I've completed the metadata for and I'm going to start to work on soon. And I'm really excited about that. So telework has really been a time where we could think about projects that may have seemed unattainable because staff is really busy. We're all busy, but we've been able to do some things from home and think about things in different ways. I would say that we have kept communication open and we keep making plans, and the supervisors talk every week. What is everyone doing? How long is a project going to last? When will each person need additional work? And I would say that when we're working on site, it's really easy for people to know what is happening in their immediate area. And you might have an idea of what is happening in another area. Maybe you've learned it during a staff meeting. But that having these ongoing weekly conversations where we really talk about how everyone's doing and what they're doing has been a way to really know when to start thinking about additional projects or how to plan people's time. And that is something that's been really vital, I think, for us. And this is my last slide, Josh, so no matter where I am on time, I think I'm gonna be okay. I would say I feel a real sense of gratitude during this time. We have our old Finding Aid was shut down on June 6th, and it transitioned it took weeks for it to be migrated into a new system. And as of last week, a collection of 14 people worked on reviewing our old Finding Aid with our new Finding Aid. And we made lists. We made lists of all kinds of things that will need to be updated. And guess what? We can do all of that via telework. And during our time in between when we were working on our old Finding Aid and when we were getting our new one, we started a conversation about language and about potentially controversial language. And our new Finding Aid is going to give us a lot of opportunities with adding things like keywords and extra searchable functions. And I will say that I'm really glad we have cameras because we're going to have a lot of dynamic conversations about how do we update things consistently. And we've also had another staff person review all of our collections that we've uploaded into the Power Library because we want to also update those descriptions. And so It's been kind of an amazing time to take on really big projects. Our finding aids are crazy. They are large. We have collections that have over 1,000 series. So when we talk about reviewing everything that's in there, it is a time-consuming thing to do. And I'm grateful for all the resources we've had. I think a lot of my section, the people that I talked to, were grateful to be able to continue to telework. And that really, at that first slide where I talked about the state archivist talking about meaningful work has been incredibly important when living through such a stressful time. Most of us are grateful to be able to put in our work day because it may be the most relaxing part of the day because you're not focused on what's going on with COVID or anything else out in the world. You can focus on something that you know how to do or that you're learning how to do. And that has been really good. And for people to be able to see that their work is being used almost right away, has really helped people stay engaged every day in their work. Hey, Josh, I'm done early.
Great, Heather. Thank you. We'll go ahead and transition over to Matt.
Okay.
All right. Well, thank you to David and the folks at PHMC for having me here today. And thank you to Adam and Heather. It was really interesting to hear your experiences and hear the similarities between what you're going through and what we're going through here at the Heinz History Center. So I'm gonna be talking about the History Center's COVID-19 collecting initiative that we started in March. You know, the History Center is one of many organizations that started this collecting initiative like this. And I imagine we're all kind of doing this a little bit differently and have different tools at our disposal and have had some different results. So I'm happy to provide a behind the scenes glimpse into our project. So a little bit about the History Center, the Heinz History Center. We were founded in 1879 as the Historical Society of Western Pennsylvania. And we have a mandate to document, preserve, and present regional history. We're located in this former ICE warehouse building that's located between downtown Pittsburgh and the Strip District neighborhood. The organization moved into this building in the mid-90s when it relaunched as the Senator John Heinz History Center. We're both a museum and an archive, so we have 5 floors of exhibits. And the library and archives is on our 6th floor. Our archives and artifact collections are stored separately and have different systems for description and cataloging and have 2 separate divisions overseeing them. But we work together, especially on collecting efforts, and our COVID-19 initiative has been no different. This effort has also been supported by other folks at the History Center working in our communications and our IT departments. And we've all been doing this working from home. I would say we have about 15 people at the organization that have been working on this project at some point. So like everyone else, in the mid-March, the History Center closed. And I remember getting to work on a Monday and being told that to pack up and take what I needed to work from home because we weren't sure when we would be able to get into the building. I would say that we had our collecting initiative launched in about a week and a half. And that is because the History Center as an organization has had some experience doing crowdsourced collections and event-based collecting initiatives. In 2018, there was a Pittsburgh synagogue shooting at the Tree of Life building in the Squirrel Hill neighborhood of Pittsburgh. And after that, the History Center's Rao Jewish History and Archives program launched a collecting initiative to document that terrible event and the subsequent response to it. This work involved creating a way for the public to submit digital content to the collection This involved using Archivit for the first time to document relevant web content and also coordinating efforts among staff who were doing some proactive collecting, going out across the city to gather documentation of memorial events that were happening in the weeks following. And this framework has informed how we approach the COVID-19 initiative. We have some different strategies here, one of which is that we are crowdsourcing digital content via our webpage. We realize that the pandemic is affecting everyone and everyone a little bit differently. So we really want to cast a broad net when it comes to collecting. And we're augmenting this through staff documentation, whether that's going out into the community to take photographs of closed buildings and playgrounds, or by identifying web content to harvest. And we're also doing the kind of more traditional collection development work of brainstorming and identifying people and organizations that might have material that would be good to include in our collection. Currently, we are in a situation where we can't travel off-site. All kind of business travel has been, for the most part, suspended. So if there's a physical collection out there that we need to take a look at or pick up, we're kind of in a holding pattern right now and just making plans with folks. So here is the page that we set up for the collecting initiative, and I'll kind of walk through the different parts of this. Up at front here, we have just some background of what we're doing and why we're doing it. We have a link to an online gallery of things that have been submitted so far that we added to the page a couple of weeks after we launched it. We have some examples of both digital and physical items that we're hoping to collect. And then at the bottom here, we have the spot where folks can upload a story or photos, video, audio, or links to websites and social media. And clicking on any of these sections, you can expand it, and we've expanded this section where folks can upload digital files. There are prompts to submit a title and description, dates, location. We do require a name and an email address, so if people want to remain anonymous, they can do so. And then we have our important guidelines and terms that have to be agreed to before submitting. And this is where we make it clear that what's being submitted will be made publicly accessible for research, and donors are providing us with a non-exclusive license to use the materials they submit. Not everything is guaranteed to be accepted. So if there's something that's way out of scope or duplicates something we already have, then that's not guaranteed to be in the collection. For people who are uploading images and video, we're asking that they only submit personally created images so they can be in that position to share their rights with us. And we're asking folks to be at least 18 years of age so they can be in a position to agree to these terms. We've had some students submit things to us, which has been great, but in those cases where it's clear that they're underage, we do respond back and ask if their parents or guardians can formally do the submission for them. And this is kind of what happens on the back end. After that submit button is pressed, we have a OneDrive folder where any file has been uploaded goes to and eventually gets downloaded onto the History Center's servers. And then there's an email that's produced that captures all that descriptive information that users have submitted. That gets sent to an email address that we have set up especially for acquisitions. And then there's a unique ID that serves as the file name for the uploaded file that also appears in the email, so we can cross-reference the two. And so we're also doing web archiving, and we're using Archivit for this. We have, we've had some submissions from the public, but I would say mostly this has been staff-directed, either library and archives staff finding things to document, or colleagues elsewhere in the History Center are well aware of our project and submitting things too. And we've been focusing on organizational websites and social media. Some examples are official updates from the Allegheny County Health Department that they've been putting online, web pages of nonprofits in the area that are working to address hunger, Facebook pages of restaurants that have had to alter their operations or even close permanently. And this is also an area where the Library and Archives has been able to offer its first completely remote internship this fall. We have an undergraduate from the University of Pittsburgh that is helping us with this project, working completely off-site, and she's helping with some quality control issues with our harvesting efforts. And I would say the progress has been, we've had some pretty good progress so far. We have about 400 submissions with images and personal stories, probably being the most popular types of content. And we've had quite a variety of experiences. We've heard from medical professionals, teachers and students, postal workers. We had an Uber driver that uploaded the kind of a day-by-day diary of their experiences in the early days of the pandemic, which was really interesting. And the staff has also been busy. At the History Center, we in normal times, we have a leads committee meeting, and that's a regular meeting that we have between archivists and curators to discuss all offers of incoming material to the collection and to brainstorm ideas for proactive collecting. Normally we'd be all crammed around a table, and which seems kind of horrifying right now. So we are doing this all virtually, and that's worked out really well. We've been able to share files and images that way. And we're using Microsoft Teams as our teleconferencing software. And I will say that with the portal, I mean, we're not discussing every single thing that gets submitted. That would just be kind of logistically challenging. But if there's an offer that is substantial or might have a physical counterpart, then we would definitely talk about it at our leads committee meeting. And we're also brainstorming ideas for individuals, businesses, organizations that might have materials that would be strong additions to our collection. So we're thinking about the businesses in the area that have pivoted to making medical equipment and PPE, nonprofits that are working on community support, businesses that have had to shut down due to the pandemic. In Pittsburgh, we've had a couple of longstanding restaurants that have closed during this period permanently. And that's an area where not only do we want to collect and document how COVID-19 affected their business, but if it's been a business that's been around for a long time, we're interested more broadly in that history. So we're thinking about the more typical archives and artifacts that we'd want to collect from them too. We've had some interesting media response. When we launched the project, we had a press release that went out that led to a couple of stories in local newspapers and radio. And then a little bit later, the Washington Post was doing a story on how historical societies and museums were documenting the pandemic, and the History Center was one of those profiled. Another piece ran in the Philadelphia Inquirer. So we've been getting kind of attention outside of the area as well. And then when we had, when the building opened to the public in July, we had a local TV crew come down and film a story here on site about the collecting initiative. And we found that anytime one of these stories ran, there was a corresponding uptick in donations. So it's been really good for us. And it's also been a good opportunity to address some key concepts that I think we're, as archivists, well aware of, but sometimes have trouble resonating with the general public. And that's that the History Center and archives in general are often interested in contemporary materials. So things like social media, Facebook pages are just as important as more traditional material. And often these contemporary created materials are born digital. So there's a whole host of preservation and access issues that go along with that. It's also been a great way to just get some attention on the work that archivists do and how this collecting initiative is a natural extension of the work we're doing normally in terms of appraising, preserving, providing access to materials of long-term value. when I've spoken to journalists, I've often talked about the 1918 flu pandemic and the lack of materials at the History Center that we have that documents that event, which is kind of surprising because Pittsburgh was hit really hard by the pandemic. And while there was the Historical Society in existence at that point, the History Center's precursor, it was very small, mostly volunteer run, definitely not as public facing as the History Center is today. And there really wasn't much evidence that the organization was interested in documenting contemporary life. It really wasn't until the 80s and 90s that the History Center began to conceive of its mission that way. So this is all to say that without archivists doing this important work, the historical record suffers. So the road ahead is a little unclear right now. The History Center opened to museum visitors on July 1st, and the library and archives opened at that time as well, to by appointment only. So staff are still splitting time between working on site and working from home. And this seems like it's going to be the new normal for the time being. At some point, we will resume site visits when we've had those restrictions on business travel lifted. Some of the other things we need to figure out in the months ahead is just how we're going to catalog and provide access to this incoming material. We've also been thinking about how we might want to bolster this effort by conducting oral histories. So there's been some successes and challenges here. And I would say the biggest challenge is that this has been an additional project and responsibility that obviously was unforeseen, that has been added to already pretty busy work plans for folks here. It would be great to be able to dedicate more staff time to this project so we could spend more time cataloging, describing, working on proactive collection development. But the pandemic has affected the History Center. Like many museums across the country, it's had an impact on our finances. We've had some partial furloughs and reorganization of staff duties during this time that have reduced the amount of time that we can spend on this project. But I would say on the plus side, the transition to working from home and working on this project from home has been surprisingly easy. And this really mirrors what Heather was just talking about. We had all this technology at the History Center already accessible to us that really facilitated work from home that nobody was really using before March, before the pandemic. I had never used Microsoft OneDrive, although I knew it was an option, and sometimes I'd get prompts to save things there. I never really used it to work from documents at home or to group edit a document. I never used the VPN connection to access the History Center server remotely. I never used Microsoft Teams for chat or video conference. And it just so happened in March, we had previously planned to update our phone system here at the History Center. And as part of that overhaul, we were able to have apps that we could download onto our personal phones that would allow us to receive calls that were coming into our work phones and to make calls from that number as well. So we've really been able to stay in touch with staff and patrons as well that way. I don't know to what extent after the pandemic, remote work will be this common at the History Center. Certainly in the library and archives, there's lots of work we have to do on site, processing, digitization, reference. Is often done on site, but it's good to know that this technology is available and relatively easy to use. And I would also say the response by the public and by the media in those early days of the pandemic was very reassuring. It was really positive. The History Center only closes for a few days out of the year, so it was very surreal to be closed for a few months. And it was great to know that there was still this interest and engagement in the work we were doing during this calamitous time for everybody. Most importantly, we are building this collection for future researchers that we believe will be of great value. So I'm happy to answer any questions about this project in the Q&A session. Thank you.
Thank you, Matt. I want to remind everybody you are able to unmute if you do have questions that you want to throw out to any of the speakers. We'll start though, Ty Stump from our staff at the State Archives will address any of the questions that have been typed in chat throughout the session. So we'll go ahead and open that up to you, Ty.
Hey, thanks, Josh. Hi, everybody. It's me, Tyler Stump. I also work at the State Archives with Josh. And we have a couple questions that have come in through chat already, so I'm going to ask them in order. And then after that, just keep on typing them into the chat thing and we can get them so everyone can hear them. I'll read them out loud for everyone. And then after that, if anybody wants to just jump in and ask our speakers directly, we can go ahead and do that. Let's see. So I'll ask the first one, and this is kind of a general one for all of our speakers, but how do you track files that are taken back and forth between home and the office? Does anybody want to answer that one?
I'll jump in if I can. We have a not terribly elaborate process, but we have some sign-out sheets that we've been using for probably decades. Mm-hmm. And I had only used them maybe once before March, and then suddenly I had to fill out an entire sheet for some things. And I still have a number of those things at home because I'm here several days a week. But that's basically how we're monitoring it. And we don't have a huge library staff. We have three employees in the library at the History Center. So it's not a whole lot of, it's not like we have dozens of people with access to our materials to take them home. And it's worked pretty well so far.
Thanks, Adam.
Tyler, I would just say at the State Archives, we're not taking original records home. I'm pretty sure our bosses would pass out if we did that. So we don't. We've taken home some hard drives to work on specific types of projects. But as far as original documents, we're not taking them home.
Mm-hmm. I would say
if that. I could clarify. I'm sorry.
Sorry, Adam.
Just to clarify, I didn't want to give anyone the impression that we're taking 1800s and 1700s things home. No, the only kinds of records that I've taken out are some folders of newspaper clippings. So we're very selective about the kinds of things we bring home.
Yeah, it's also the case at the History Center that we don't have things leave the premises. So we've had some folks that were processing collections, some project archivists who were some of the first folks to start working regularly back on site when we could. So I would say in May, when things started to loosen up a little bit, they were able to come back and start working, more so on site.
Great. And actually for everyone who's wondering, our second session in the seminar today is going to be about records management for teleworking workers. And so that'll cover a little bit like then what do we do with the non-archival records when they're going home? So stick around for that if you're able this afternoon. All right, our second question, this one is for Matt specifically, but somebody asked, how does the Heinz Center promote COVID-19 collecting? So maybe you could elaborate on what you talked about a little bit.
Right, so when we launched our webpage and our collecting initiative, I mentioned that we had a press release that went out that led to some stories. We also used social media channels to announce what we were doing. And one thing I didn't talk about was that there was a blog post that my colleague, Carly Lowe, who's been really instrumental in this project, she wrote a piece that just kind of went into more detail about what we were doing, the types of materials we were looking for, and who we were kind of hoping to hear from. So I think all of those things have helped get the word out.
Did you find that one of those was more effective than the other ones, Matt?
I would say the press release and getting this on the radar of media helped a lot. I think there was definitely some interest in what museums were doing during this time period. And this led to some interesting media spots. Carly was on a AM talk radio show one night and reached a whole different audience than we might normally through as opposed posted like a story in the local newspaper. So, I as I mentioned, every time a piece ran in the somewhere, there was a corresponding uptick in items being offered to us.
That's great. Yeah, super. All right, our next question, and this one, it looks like it's more a general one for everybody. Did you encounter projects that non-archival staff or your volunteers could do at home to supplement what the archive staff have been accomplishing? Anyone wants to just jump in and take that one?
I can start on that. One of our main concerns when we shut down in York was, how are we going to cope with all of the genealogy requests that we continue to receive? And we did continue to receive them. For the first few weeks after the shutdown, the requests definitely dropped off. But then I think as people had more time at home, they started thinking about projects and questions that they wanted answered. So we actually ended up with, I think it was 10 to 12 different requests, which doesn't sound like a huge number, but I mean, it's a substantial number for us. But the problem with it was that we couldn't do anything. We couldn't help these people, which was pretty frustrating because we like to get things back in a decent amount of time. So one of the things I did when we started to visit on site once or twice a week was to try to coordinate some online work with our volunteers. And that was partially successful because many of our genealogy researchers, our volunteers, have access to things like ancestrynewspapers.com. But unfortunately, the bulk of our family file collections are not digitized. And so those kinds of materials have to be researched on site. So that was a limitation. It limited how effective we could be at doing that. The other thing I just briefly mentioned is that some other departments at the York County History Center were able to provide online content. Specifically, our visitor services department, of which Bart Stump, Tyler knows who Bart is, and he's been great at providing some things for Facebook, This Day in History kinds of posts and short videos. So people outside our department have been providing some great content.
Great.
Yeah, at the library and archives, we've had volunteers working on some things remotely that they would be typically working on site. So oral history transcriptions was something that they could work on, helping out with some background descriptions that would be later added to catalog records or finding aids, and reference. Like Adam, we've had some requests. We have actually had more reference requests coming in than usual via phone and email during this time period. So we've definitely been relying on our volunteers to do some searches in newspapers.com, Ancestry, to help fulfill those requests.
And Tyler, I would say for at the State Archives, in collections management, our volunteers, which we have some really amazing volunteers that often come in one day a week, they really handle documents. They're working on projects with glass plate negatives, and so our volunteer squad is really quiet right now. We have not looked at providing them with projects to do from home. Mm-hmm. But we have focused sort of those oral history transcription projects and the copied survey project really to make sure that our clerks have work to do all the time. So really our job was to make our full-time staff, make sure that they were all engaged in meaningful work. And so we were just about to select our summer interns the week after we started telework. And our internship program was just sort of closed for this year. And hopefully it'll be back next year. But that sort of went quiet this summer.
Okay, those were all the questions that we had typed in the chat, but if you have more, and if we don't get to everyone's questions, we would be happy to get in touch with all of our speakers, so we'll make sure that you can reach out to them directly. But if anybody wants to go ahead and unmute themselves and ask our speakers any questions, we've got about 5 more minutes left.
I would just mention, Tyler, that it's also Ask an Archivist Day, and many archives are participating in that today, including us. And many of our staff members are taking turns throughout the course of the day, and there's a schedule of talking points and topics throughout the day. So archives across the country are doing that. It's a fun thing to be involved in. And so if you have a couple minutes today to see what's happening out there in the social media world, it's a fun day for us to do show and tell.
Yeah, good. Thanks for bringing that up, Heather. Yeah, if anybody's on Twitter, go ahead and please check that out.
Okay. And I guess if nobody else is going to chime in, we did get a question that came in just asking about future planning. So if things continue, or what are you looking at for next year? I know, you know, a lot of around now might be the time that we'd start planning for things in late winter or early spring. Do you have any thoughts on what that might look like for your organization?
I know for the State Archives, we all had to do another 10-month range plan for people with both on-site projects and telework projects. And so we submitted those a couple months ago, like a month or so ago. So we, you know, that agile planning and keeping our eyes out for things that people can do from home or for at least part of the time is important. And I know that before we even went home, one of the things that our State Archivist said was, listen, we need projects for now, but even when we go back, we have to be actively thinking about projects that we should be preparing for if we need to return to telework. So that is something that we're constantly thinking about. It's part of, you know, Kurt Bell's on this call. He's been working on knowledge base entries for me. He was able to write an article that was published during this time, which was a dream of his since I've been his manager for over 5 years, and it happened. And so it is a time to reach out to your staff and see what their hopes and dreams are, because sometimes, hi Kurt, sometimes it can happen during telework. It is sort of a magical time to sort of dream outside of the box.
I suppose I could echo a lot of the same things that Heather mentioned before the York County History Center. We're hoping that things are going to continue on as they are right now. We reduced our hours when we reopened in July, so for the time being, we're going to be doing 6 hours a day, 5 days a week, as far as reading room availability. But there is always that possibility that, you know, something like the spring could happen again, I suppose. I don't even like to think about it, but we're in a position right now where we're fortunately familiar with a lot of these projects, and we already are much more geared toward online content than we were. We're trying to broadcast all of our in-person events, which there aren't many to begin with, but we're trying to do webinars with everything so that we can reach people who are not comfortable in attending. And in the event that things change again, we'll be pretty well positioned, I think.
Yeah, and that's one of the things that's changed for us is our programming. We're doing and planning for that all to be virtual for, you know, at least until next summer. So we have some genealogy programs that we do in the spring. We're working to do that all virtually. And in fact, we did one last June, I think it was, that was all virtual, our first offering like that. So we have some other programs that we have, we offer throughout the year, and we're going to be doing that via Zoom, and we're going to be putting up recordings of all those programs online through our YouTube channel. But other than that, I would say things are somewhat normal-ish, I would say, in the library and archives. We do have patrons coming in by appointment only right now, and fortunately, the way our kind of office area is set up here, we can have staff back and pretty well spread out. So we have some different spaces we can use. I mentioned we have some project archivists who are working on grants. So we're trying to keep on target with all of those grant deadlines. And a lot of those involve digitization. So we are just generally, and as well through grants, trying to get more of our collections online so that folks don't necessarily have to come into the History Center to see them.
Okay, well, we're on time, so I guess we'll wrap now. I just want to thank Adam and Matt and Heather very much. I think you all knocked this session out of the park. Really, there's just a lot of really great information. I know everybody will agree with me on that. So we're going to close now, but if you're signed up, we have our second session of the day, which will be starting at, I believe, 1:30, and that's on records management for teleworking archivists. And so the same Zoom link that you're using for this session will also let you into that second one if you'd like to attend that one. Without further ado, have a great rest of your day. If we're not going to see you later, and if we'll see you at 1:30, we'll see you then. Thanks, everyone.
Right. Thank you for the opportunity.